Hello my dear students, please subscribe our YouTube channel for more free video lectures and click on bell button for notifications and visit our website to purchase full course.
Welcome back to the session. Last session we had been discussed about flux and flux properties and its functions we had been discussed. Okay, now this session we are going to see what is filler rod and what's the functions of filler rod, we'll see. Okay. Filler rod. Yeah, just we have already defined this filler rod, that is additional molten metal is supplied to the weld pool is come under filler rod. Okay, the function of this filler rod is, so additional molten metal has to be supplied to the weld joint. Okay, suppose these are the two plates which are going to be joined by the welding process, then so these are the edge preparation. Okay, so to this particular joint, okay, so additional molten metal, so actually with a flame heat this particular workpiece also get melted, workpiece will get melt, and also whatever the molten metal we got by melting the workpieces, it is not sufficient to form a joint, right? For that purpose what we have to do is, here we have to use some additional filler rod. Okay, so this filler rod with available heat of flame, it will get melt and supplies some molten metal to the basement, that means to the weld joint. Okay, so that the joint is going to be formed, that is what the function of this particular filler rod. All right, yeah, take that. Filler rod function is, it supplies additional filler rod to the weld joint. Okay, so right here it is a filler rod, right? Yeah, but this filler rod is comes into feature or comes into welding process whenever the plate thicknesses are less than 5 mm. Okay, if thickness is if it is greater than 5 mm, okay, then that time this filler rod is going to be yours. If suppose the thickness of the plates to be joined is less than 5 mm, then there is no need to use of additional filler rod. With the help of the square joint we can make the joint. Okay, yeah. Take this point. If thickness of the plates, if thickness of plates to be joined, thickness of the plates to be joined less than 5 mm, no need to use additional filler material. Additional filler material. Okay, what is that? So what I'm trying to tell you, if this thickness is less than 5 mm, then no need to use of this filler rod. This filler rod is going to be used in gas welding whenever the plates are going to be joined, thickness is more than 5 mm only. Okay. Right. Gas welding proceed with, gas welding proceed without filler rod, without filler rod, call puddling operation, call puddling operation. Called puddling operation. What is that? Gas welding. Suppose gas welding without filler rod, if you perform, then it is possible, sorry, then it is called as a puddling operation. See that if the plate thickness are less than 5 mm, so we can prepare a square like this between the two plates and we can join. So these thickness of the plates to be joined, T is less than 5 mm. Okay. If T is less than 5 mm, then we can prepare a square joint. With square joint, we can form welding. Alright, guys? Alright? So, if it is more than 5 mm thickness, then we have to prepare some kind of joint. So, because of this kind of joint, there is a gap existing between the two plates to be joined. Into this gap, the filler material supplies additional molten metal for filling the joint. Alright? Yeah. Next. So, take this. Now, let us move forward. Yeah, just now we had been discussed that if thickness is more than less than 5 mm, then no need to use of additional filler rod. Okay, if suppose thickness is more than 5 mm, then we need to use the filler rod for filling the joint. Okay, now along with the filler rod, we have to prepare some edge preparation to the workpieces also. Okay, so right. If thickness of the plates to be joined, thickness of plates to be joined is more than 5 mm, additional filler rod should be used. Along with that, edge preparation to the workpieces must be done. Okay, so like edge preparation like V joint and U joint, and last one is a J joint. Like this, edge preparation has to be performed. Okay, now let me give you that small example of this. Okay, this is a V joint. It's a V joint, and U joint is, you know, okay, this is U joint, and J joint, it should be like this. Okay, so these are the two plates to be going to be joined when thickness is more than 5 mm. So whenever the thickness is more than 5 mm, then additional filler rod has to be used for filling the joint. Okay, this is what the filler rod. This filler rod supply additional molten metal to the weld region so that joint is going to be form. So this is similar to all the joints. Okay. So the function of this filler rod is whenever the gap existing between the two workpieces, that gap is going to be filled with a filler rod. Okay. Here also we use a filler rod. This function of filler rod is to supply additional molten metal to the base material or to the weld joint. Okay. Here also filler rod used, and this will be supply some molten metal to the base material. Okay. Filler rod, and this also filler rod. All right, guys. Now, so we can conclude that whenever you do that edge preparation, so that there is a gap existing between the two plates to be joined, into this gap the filler material supplies additional molten metal to fulfill the joint. Okay. because of joint preparation, some gap existing between two plates. All right. To this molten metal supplied. Okay. So this is how the filler rod is going to be function in the gas welding process. Okay. Without filler rod, if the gas welding proceed, that is come under what is that? Puddling operation. If filler rod is used more than the 5 mm thickness plates only. So below the 5 mm thickness plates, there is no need to use of the filler material to the joint. With the only square joint, we can perform the welding operation. Okay. So take these points and we'll move for the next. Correct. Next. All right. Now, filler rod is performing some function which is supplying additional molten metal to the base material, right? Now, what properties it must have? So, one material, if you want to recommend to become as a additional filler material, which type of properties it must have? Okay. Now, let us see that properties of filler material. Filler rod properties. So, with the diagram, we will see this, and this is a workpiece. So this is our weld pool. To this weld pool, this filler rod fellow get melted and supply molten metal to the base material. This is what we have been discussed till now. Okay, this is all molten metal of the workpiece. All right. Right. This is a filler rod, and this supplying additional molten metal by melting this fellow. It is supplying molten metal. This is additional molten metal. Additional molten metal. And here it is a weld pool. Right. Now my question is, what properties this filler rod must have? Okay, we just highlight this. What properties it must have? Okay, first, density. Whatever the density of the base material, that must be equal to filler material. That means filler rod density material must be equal to the base material density. Suppose if this fellow having different density and base metal having different density, then what happen na? This particular base material, sorry, filler material develops some molten metal, base metal also develops some molten metal. If density differences are there, then these two are not going to be mixed. Okay. So if these are not mixing, then the molten metal of the filler rod will be separate, molten metal of the base metal will be separate, so that it is not possible to perform a proper weld joint. That is why you have to very careful during the selection of the filler rod, that must have a density equal to the base material density. Okay. If density differences existing between the filler rod and workpiece, what happened na? The molten metals of the filler material, molten metal of the base material will not going to be mixed. For that reason, we have to take the density of the filler material must be equal to the density of the workpiece material. Okay. Right. Right. Here I just highlight the first property, the density of filler material must be equal to density of workpiece material. Density of workpiece. Okay, isn't it? Right. If suppose, why this is, why it is necessary? Because, okay, if density differences existing, if density differences existing between filler rod and workpiece, between filler rod and workpiece, then molten metals will not get mixed. Okay, so that both molten metals not mix properly, both molten metal will not mixed, not mixed. Okay, that is the reason why we have to take care of that. Suppose it's the density of the filler material and it is the density of the workpiece material. So first point is here I just highlight that in the bracket I'll write it as density of the filler material must be equal to density of the workpiece material, isn't it, guys? Right. Next, second property. What next property? Densities must be equal. Next, how about that melting point temperature? The melting point temperature of the filler rod must be less than the melting point temperature of the base material. First, filler rod has to be melt. That is why we have to maintain that melting point temperature of the filler rod must be less than the melting point temperature of the base material. In worst condition, we have to select the filler material melting point temperature equal to the base material temperature, base material melting point temperature. All right. Yeah. Next, melting point. This is a density and here melting point temperature of filler material, melting point of filler material and here melting point of workpiece, melting point of workpiece. Okay. So melting point of melting point of filler material must be less than melting point of base material or workpiece material. Okay, so melting point of base material, isn't it? Next, third one. Here we can write it as, so melting point temperature of filler material less than the melting point temperature of the workpiece. Okay, in worst case it may be melting point of filler material equal to melting point temperature of the workpiece material also, you can take that, that is no problem. But never melting point temperature of the filler material is greater than melting point temperature of the workpiece material. What happened? So if it is having more higher melting point temperature than the workpiece, what happened na? During the welding process, first workpiece get melted and it will not get melted. So it has to melt and it has to supply some additional molten metal to the base material. Then only it is possible to make a sound weld joint. That is why we have to very careful in selecting the melting point temperature of the filler rod must be less than or equal to the melting point temperature of the base material. So very important. All right. Next, one more thing. See, here this filler rod developing some molten metal, workpiece also developing some molten metal. But both molten metals are ready to mixing in each other. Then only it is possible to make a sound weld joint. Isn't it? Clear, guys? Whatever the molten metal developed by the filler material, that must be readily mixed with the molten metal of the base material. Then only it is possible to make a sound weld joint. Why it is? Suppose this molten metal is not ready to mix in that, then it is possible to make the joint? No. So that is why we have to take care of that. Molten metal of the filler material must be mixed with the molten metal of the workpiece. Clear, guys? Are you getting my point? See here, this is the molten metal of the filler rod. And this will be the molten metal of the workpiece. That is why this molten metal and this molten metal both ready to mix in each other. Then only it is possible to make a sound weld joint. Alright. Yeah. The molten metal of filler rod. Molten metal of filler rod. Readily mix with the molten metal of base material. Molten metal of base material. Okay, so otherwise it is not possible to produce a sound weld joint. It is not possible to make a sound weld joint. Sound weld joint. Alright, guys. This is what about the this one. Next, fourth point. Fourth property. So, what is that fourth property? Whatever the molten metal developed by the filler material, that is ready to flow in each and every sections of the weld joint. So then only it is possible to make a weld sound joint. All right. So now let me explain you with this diagram. See here what I'm trying to explain you. This is what our joint. Okay, in the joint, what I'm trying to explain you, this is what our filler rod. Okay, this filler rod develops some molten metal. Okay, it will get melt and produce the molten metal. This molten metal ready to move each and every corner and each and every section of the base material. Sorry, weld joint. Then only it is possible to produce a sound weld joint. Are you getting my point, guys? What I'm trying to tell you, here it will develop some liquid. That liquid ready to flow each and every corner of the weld joint. Okay, that is why we have to maintain that viscosity of the molten metal of this particular filler rod must be as less as possible. Okay, so that is why the viscosity of the molten metal of the filler rod must be less than or as much as possible. It should be a less. Okay, right. So molten metal of filler rod, molten metal of filler rod readily flow each and every corner of weld joint. Okay, so these are the properties must be possessed by the filler rod, otherwise it is not possible to flow. So that is why density of not density, sorry, viscosity. Viscosity of molten metal as minimum as possible. As minimum as possible. Alright. Viscosity of molten metal, a filler rod, as minimum as possible so that it can flow each and every corner of the weld joint. Okay. So here I'll show you, it is a filler rod. And here it is a workpiece. And here filler rod molten metal. Filler rod molten metal. Alright. Okay. So right, this is what the properties must be possessed by the filler rod. Okay, so take this and we'll move for the next. Okay, next is okay, now let us move for production of oxygen and acetylene for oxyacetylene welding. Okay, so for gas welding, we have to produce the oxygen and acetylene. First, we look on that how to produce oxygen. Later on, we move for production of the acetylene, we'll see. Okay, so now topic is production of oxygen. So simple and easy. Production of oxygen. Right. How to produce oxygen? The best and cheapest method for producing the oxygen is from atmospheric air. So from the atmospheric air, it is very easy and cheapest method for producing the oxygen. Okay. The best and cheapest method. Cheapest method for producing oxygen is from atmospheric air. Atmospheric air. Okay. So then what are the elements in atmospheric air and how to produce that? Let me explain you that. Okay. Yeah. So first we'll take a look on that. Here is atmospheric air. So in that atmospheric air, and three major elements are there. Okay, here it is nitrogen. It is about 78.7%. Okay, oxygen in atmospheric air is 21%, and organic elements is about 0.3%. So these are the atmospheric air contains. From this we have to produce the atmospheric, from this we have to separate the oxygen. Okay. So the nitrogen condensation temperature or boiling point temperature, boiling or condensation temperature, boiling point or condensation temperature is here. For nitrogen it is it is -195.8°C. okay, it is -195°C, and oxygen boiling temperature is -183°C. okay, now organic elements boiling point temperature is about -185.7°C. okay, what I do is, it's a simple and easy atmospheric air, it contains nitrogen is 78%, oxygen is 21%, and organic elements 0.3%. I just wrote there boiling or condensation temperatures. Okay, so all these temperatures are at 1 atmospheric bar pressure. All these at 1 bar atmospheric pressure. Now this air, decrease the temperature below -220°C. So if I brought or if I bring this fellow to up to -220°C, so that all these fellows are become liquid now. So from there I separate nitrogen, I separate organic elements, and I'll keep the oxygen remaining same, so that that liquid oxygen we can store in cylinders. Okay, now let me give you the another block diagram how to separate oxygen from these all elements. Okay, now cool atmospheric air, cool atmospheric air, cool atmospheric air below -220°C. Now what happened? So atmospheric air is cool up to -220°C. Here what happened? So liquid air will be possible. That means liquid atmospheric air. Okay. So now below this, if I after that, so here what we can get here, so all the nitrogen, oxygen, organic elements in the form of liquid. Okay, so these are below their boiling point temperatures. Okay, right. See O2, N2, organic elements in liquid state, in liquid state. All right, now if I heat these two up to -196°C, so -196°C heat, here in this region you have to apply heat. So what happened if I heat this fellow to -196°C, then nitrogen will get evaporate, will get only oxygen and organic elements in liquid state. Okay, so if I heat these to -196°C, then I can get O2 and organic elements in liquid state, elements in liquid state. All right, now how about nitrogen? At this temperature nitrogen will get evaporated, because nitrogen boiling point temperature is -185.8°C, that we have heated that up to -186°C, so that N2 get evaporate. All right guys, right, next again you apply heat. up to minus 185 degrees centigrade. That means 186 degrees centigrade. Again, you apply heat. Then what happened? So minus, at minus 196, only O2 organic elements in the liquid state, so that nitrogen will get evaporated. From 196, again you heat up to 186 degrees centigrade. So at 186 degrees centigrade, what happened? Organic elements also will get evaporated. Only you can get liquid oxygen. Okay, at minus 186 degrees centigrade, so liquid O2 available and organic elements evaporated. Organic elements evaporated. Okay, so here at minus 198.6 degrees centigrade, liquid O2 available and organic elements are going to be evaporated. So that we got only liquid O2 now. Now, so here storage of the oxygen will be the difficulty. So always you prefer store the oxygen in the liquid state in the cylinders only, because liquid O2 having the lowest specific volume when compared to the gaseous O2. That is why we prefer to store the oxygen in the liquid state only. Clear everyone? Here, excuse me. Here what I did is, it's a very simple and easy. What is that? I collected the atmospheric air and I found the boiling point temperatures of that values. So above these boiling point temperatures, I brought the temperature so that what happened? All these elements are get liquid state. Okay. Now from the liquid state, I just heat 186 degrees centigrade so that N2 will get evaporated in the next stage. Now after getting N2 evaporated, only O2 and organic elements in the liquid state will be there. Again, from 196 degrees centigrade, I apply heat up to 186 degrees centigrade so that what happened? Organic elements will get evaporated and I'll find only one liquid O2. Okay, so now I'll tell you the storage of the oxygen. Storage of oxygen always preferred to store in liquid state only, because liquid oxygen having lower specific volume when compared to the gaseous oxygen. Okay, so O2 always prefer to store in a liquid state only. O2 prefer store in a liquid state only, because liquid O2 have less specific volume than gaseous O2. Okay, that is why we always prefer to store the oxygen in the liquid state only. All right, so take this and we'll move for the next. Okay, now let us move for production of acetylene. Next is production of acetylene. Production of acetylene. I'll write it as a C2H2 only. Okay, right. How to produce acetylene? Okay. Yeah, here if calcium carbide mixing with the water, which generates the acetylene. Okay, yeah. Calcium carbide react with water. And produce C2H2. Calcium carbide react with water and produce C2H2. All right. Now, so let me give you the relation. CaC2 calcium carbide plus H2O is gives rise to C2H2 plus CaO. Right. So calcium carbide react with the water and produce the acetylene. All right, guys. Right. Now let us see. Actually, for doing this process, we have two methods. What is that? What I'm trying to tell you, calcium carbide is if you allow the water to flow and we mix the water and calcium carbide so that it is possible to produce the acetylene. For producing this acetylene by this method, we have two methods. And two methods are available for doing this process. All right, guys. Right. First one is water to carbide and second one is carbide to water. Okay. First one is water to carbide and second one is the carbide to water. First we'll highlight this method, later we'll see on the this one. Okay, water to carbide method we'll see. Okay. Here in this, calcium carbide crystals are placed at the bottom of the container. These are calcium carbide crystals. So CaC2 crystals. Alright. So onto the CaC2 crystals, we have to allow the water. So here we'll take some water. Then, which is at the top of the container, and from there we just allow the water to flow down onto the calcium carbide crystals so that this water, see, this is water. Okay, so water, when we allow the water to flow onto the calcium carbide crystals so that this develops the acetylene. Okay, now from here we can get acetylene. Okay, so from here we can get acetylene. So this is what the way of producing the water to carbide. From water is allowed to flow onto the fall down onto the calcium carbide crystal so that water and calcium carbide crystals mix together and produce the acetylene, which is collected at the side of the container. Okay, but by using this method, whatever the acetylene we got, it is only used for shop people. Okay, repair works only. So it is not possible to, this method cannot produce the acetylene continuously for large type of the large welding process. That means continuous welding process, this is production of the acetylene is not sufficient. That is why this method will be used for the shop people and also for small repair works, and it is not used for the continuous welding process, because for continuous welding process, the acetylene has to supply continuously in a large amount. But by using this method, very small amount of the acetylene only we can get. All right, guys. Right. Now I just highlight the features of this fellow. By this method, production of C2H2, production of C2H2 is less and used by shop people, and small repair works only. Okay, this method cannot supply continuous acetylene for continuous welding process, gas welding process. This method not able to produce large amount of acetylene for continuous production. All right, guys. So this is what enough. Okay, right. So this is what the water to carbide method. So here water is allowed to flow into the calcium carbide crystal so that it is possible to generate some amount of the acetylene. But this acetylene is not sufficient for continuous production. It is a small amount and it will be used for small repair works and job people. Shop people use for generating this method. All right. So take this one. We'll move for the carbide to water. Right. Next is move for carbide to water. Yeah. This process, what happened now? Water to carbide. In previous case, what we had been done, that is, onto the carbide crystals, we offer water and fall down onto that. But here in this process, what happened? In place of calcium carbide crystals, we use the calcium carbide powder. So because of this powder, what happened? This powder is allowed to fall down onto the water so that acetylene is going to be generated. Okay. Now explain this with the help of the diagram. Okay. So we'll take one container. Okay, here in this container, water is collected. Okay, so here it is, water, and here we have allowed that some amount of powder particles of C2H2. Here it is, CaC2 powder. Do remember. So what is the difference between the previous case and this case, guys? Here in previous case, what happened here, this let me finish this diagram. I'll come back to you. Here in previous case, crystals we had used, calcium carbide crystals we had used, but in this case we use powders of calcium carbide. Okay, so this is continuously allowed to fall onto the water, so that these calcium carbide powder and this water will react each other and generate the acetylene, and we can collect continuous acetylene or PR. All right, guys. Now here I just want to highlight one more thing. By using this method, it is possible to produce the continuous acetylene, so that this can be used for the large scale of the production, large repair works. So for cutting tools and dies, for welding the tools and dies, and also here continuous production, we can get the acetylene continuously by this process. Okay. And one more thing here, I just want to highlight here, it is a large equipment. So beside this equipment, some roll mills are there. So from the roll mills, calcium carbide crystals get crushed and become powder and supplied to this equipment. It is a large and wide of the equipment. So that is why, so large space will be occupied in the industry and produce the continuous acetylene for gas welding process. Are you getting my point, guys? What I'm trying to tell you here, it is a powder, na? Beside this, the roll mills are there. Okay, so rollers, these are rollers, and this is also a roller. Into the roller, we push the calcium carbide crystals. Okay, so these are all CaC2 crystals. All right, these crystals will get crushed in the rollers and become powder of calcium carbide powder, and it is supplied to the this particular container. Okay, and it is a calcium carbide powder. Okay, so that is why what I'm here, what I gave you the this diagram to understand, it is a large size of the equipment. All right, now see here we just highlight a few points related to this. Okay, and first point we can write it as so here calcium carbide powder is allowed to fall down in the water, which is react with the water and generate the large amount of the acetylene. Okay, in this process, CaC2, that means calcium carbide powder, is allowed to flow, allowed to fall on water, which react and produce large amount of acetylene, which produce large amount of acetylene. All right, guys, and this method gives continuous production of acetylene, continuous production of acetylene. All right, guys, next, it is a large and wide equipment. So beside this, some roll mills are used, which are used for production of crystals of the calcium carbide into powders of calcium carbide. It's a large equipment. It's a large equipment. Beside this, a roll mill maintain for continuous production of calcium carbide powder from the calcium carbide crystals. Alright guys, this is what happening in this particular one. Okay, now this can be used in industry. This method particularly used in the industries. Alright. Now, so one more thing, storage of acetylene. So always the acetylene prefer to store in a particular, what is that? Acetone. Okay. So always, I'll write one more point here. Always acetylene prefer to store in acetone. So clear guys. So what so few points I just summarize this process. So what is the difference between in water to carbide? What happened? Water is flowing onto the calcium carbide crystal. Here carbide to water, carbide particles, that means calcium carbide particles is allowed to fall onto the water, so that these two will get react and large amount of the acetylene in a continuous manner produced for large scale of the production. Okay, so this method particularly used in the industries for mass production and continuous production. Okay, and one more thing, here it is a large equipment. Beside this, some roll mills are there. These roll mills crushing the calcium carbide crystals and convert them into powder, and these powder particles are continuously supplied into this particular container, so that continuous acetylene is going to be produced. After production of acetylene storage is always preferable to store in a acetone only. Okay, so right, this is about the how to produce the oxygen, how to produce the acetylene for oxyacetylene welding process. All right, so take these points. We'll move for the next. Now the session is going to be end now. Okay, you just copy this and we'll continue the next lecture. Thank you.